we're praying, and Greg and I have already prayed about tonight, and I want to share this. The reason this is important for Christians is because the greatest deception in the history of the world, the one that Jesus spoke about, that basically said if he didn't shorten the days, that even the elect would be deceived. So that's what's going on in all avenues of the world, both natural and supernatural. Right now we're at a point of convergence. That convergence is that everything that's been, if you will, spooky, bumpy in the night and stuff is coming into our realm. And literally, that which was kept, I believe, out of our immediate visual and audio sights and our ability to perceive it is now gone. So in essence, God has given mankind the ability by free will to choose if they're going to follow him or they're going to follow the evil one. And so I'm going to bring on Greg and let him speak. Now, here's the thing, ladies and gentlemen. This is critical to your understanding because, number one, as Christians, you're going to have to be able to give an answer. You're going to have to be able to rise above this stuff in faith. And so, again, Doug, share this. Both Greg and I are walking circumspectly. We've prayed, asked the Lord not to let us go where we shouldn't go. And this may sound a little bit ominous and melodramatic, but every time you know you do a show like this, you go, God, help me to share what needs to be shared, but not to go beyond that which you want us to go beyond. So I know this. I can speak for Greg and I can speak for myself. We both are yielded to that and yielded literally to the Spirit of the living God, and we want to share with you what's going on, because all over the web bots, Cliff High is getting so many predictive linguistics that, you know, the major religions of the world are going to undergo a tremendous shaking. The lies that many people have believed, and so what is going to happen is the great deception is simply going to be this, and this is the simplified version, that there is no God, Jesus is not real, and that the aliens created us and they're coming back to save us. All the new ancient technology, all the new understanding of true history will launch us into the golden age of man, and first of all, men will become gods, living forever in perpetual pleasure and perversion. That's a nutshell. I can back up everything I say in that statement, but I want to bring Greg on, and Greg, thank you for coming on tonight.
Well, Steve, I, as always, cannot begin to thank you for being number one, my Christian brother, one of the closest I have in the entire world, if not the closest. I tell you, it's been far too long, but I was far too ill for a long time and just couldn't do it. But I tell you, I'm looking forward with great anticipation for what the Lord is going to do tonight for hundreds of thousands, perhaps a few million listeners around the globe that are having trouble, frankly, digesting, accepting, and moving forward with a plan, because it is so overwhelming at times. And so I just want you to know that when I am contemplating a show like tonight, there's two things at work for me. Having been a state trooper and federal investigator and so forth, it's hard for me to say, oh, okay, yeah, Steve Quayle, yeah, I know Steve. And, well, what do you think of his information and his books and his DVDs and so forth? And I say, well, what are you getting at? Well, do you believe him or not? And I step back figuratively and literally at times, and I say, of course I do. He's my Christian brother. He's doing a job that many of you cannot do, will not do. And because of that, it's left to a literal handful of people that are willing to step out on the plank and move towards the end of the ship. So when that happens, it's revealed to you his latest about the Nazi, well, concubines under the ice, about the giants, and you know, many of you, that he's been writing about that for years. And I will tell you that I have checked, because I wanted to be totally in compliance with what Jesus would have me say and do, this is so critically important. I'm not the only one tonight listening that is a police officer, sheriff's deputy, or other law enforcement person. And the reason that's critical is because the folks that are listening that fit into those categories, we were trained. And so I was in that mold from fourth grade on. Now, why is that important? Well, because the information that you're going to hear tonight, and many of you have read about and watched the DVDs that Steve has put out, and there's more coming, you must grasp what that means to all of us. I can't tell you the number of people that are involved in this at all levels, military and police at high levels, with some shipboard personnel. It's all coming together to serve one purpose, and that's to make real and understandable the situation that we find ourselves in. If you've ever read the Bible, then you understand. We are approaching very quickly what I believe is, in fact, the biblical end time scenario. In fact, we may be already on the first step. And if that's the case, which I believe it is, then we have no choice. Gentlemen, do you want to defend your families? Do you want to be there for your children, even though they're 25 or 30 years old? And they're afraid to admit that they didn't listen when you were trying to tell them about this? Is it really a tough one when they come home on a weekend with their families and they pull you aside and they say, Dad, is it going to get that bad? Now, what are you going to tell them? I've already been in that position with my son, who was a police officer, and others of the law enforcement family. And ladies and gentlemen out there that are listening tonight, thank you for tuning in. I told you you wouldn't be disappointed. You won't be. Not that we're trying to make some kind of weird theater presentation, but we're certainly going to tell you what we know, what we believe is the truth, and what you can do to get yourselves ready. What we want is for you to be prepared physically. Be prepared with your stock of needs, food and water and guns and ammo. And I'm not going to mince words, but I'm trying to get my wife trained, and she is an excellent shot. And I said, you know, if something happens, you got to be able to protect yourself, because I'm going to push you back and take off front and center. And if I don't make it, then you've got to be able to protect the kids and our grandkids, so forth. So all of this comes down to this. Under the ice, there is a situation that has come about that I don't think anyone really thought would occur. And that was, or that is, that the creatures known as the giants, the Nephilim, are coming awake. I don't understand how that's possible, but I believe it is. And Steve can perhaps expand on that a little bit later. But what we have are creatures, and the only way they can be stopped that I know of is with copper-tipped ammunition, arrowheads, spearheads, whatever is the weapon at hand. Now, I know there's a few of you folks that are going, okay, he's taking me off the rails pretty quick here. No, don't do that. For the sake of your family, friends, please don't do that. Hear it out. Put the test before the Lord. And if he says, yes, this is what is happening, then please, please do not ignore the warnings of God's men and women. If you do, you will not survive long. In fact, you will be one of the first to become a casualty because you weren't prepared. My mother was Cherokee. I am Cherokee, in part. And my family, on her side, of course, is part Cherokee. And I'll tell you that what she has told me over the years, her nickname was Lizzie Lightfoot, because she ran everywhere. And she could put a team of horses together and pull a hay wagon quicker than men that have been farming for 50 years. And I was very proud of her down in the farm in central Illinois, because she was, she believed in what she was, who she was, and she was proud of it. And that's not to say that she accepted the Native religion, because I told her over and over, that's a rough road to go down. Don't do that. Stay with the Christian religion at all costs. And so about 6 months ago, I received a call from a gentleman in northern Canada, Northwest Territories, and he questioned me, and he said, "Do you know Steve Quayle?" And I said, "I do very well." And he said, "Is he believable?" And I said, "Brother, I would take his word over the word of any living human being. He's that trustworthy." Now, if it's convenient for you to say, "Well, I don't know that I can believe this," well, then that's your choice. But you take your life and your family's life in your hands, and it will not be good. So when he called and I told him that, he said, "All right, I've talked to a few others of the faith and of the brotherly group of natives," and he said, "So I'm going to take you at your word." And I said, "All right, what can I do for you?" And he said, "Greg, I think that we've run onto a potential nest of Nephilim." And I said, "Okay, can you describe to me what you've run into?" And he began to tell me a story that unfolded, that if I had not been a deep man of faith, and if I did not absolutely accept that we are at the precipice of the dawn of an evil age, then I guess, well, it just wouldn't have unfolded the way it did. But fortunately, because he said, "Well, I want you to know that I'm a Christian. My family are Christian. My tribal clan are Christians. And we are keeping our eyes peeled on an area up where we are," and I'm not going to give you any more than what I've given you for obvious reasons. I don't want him to be at all in jeopardy of anything except a continued courage and warrior spirit that is almost beyond my ability to grasp if I hadn't been involved in that in years past and other theaters. It would just be almost impossible. And so I do understand, folks, when you are out there trying to put common sense and understanding of these things down on paper or just to understand them at all. So I am with you on that. I do understand. But you've got to get past that step and move on into now what? And so he was asking me, "What can we do?" And they are, by their own choice, because it was so serious, they are leaning on their understanding of what it takes to move ahead with a protective shield for their people, a wider clan, and the people in their geographical and country area. And so with that said, he said, now, is there any way we can protect ourselves? And I said, yes, but there are very few trails left open to you. And so I began to explain that, and I had checked on this and got some good confirmation that if you're dealing with Nephilim, they are able to find out where you are and who you are. And by, get this now, a scent. Do you remember the poem when we were growing up? Fee-fi, fo-fum. I smell the blood of an Englishman. Now, put two and two together. And so with that in mind, you have these Nephilim that are preparing to come up from their base in the Antarctic. Now, what has happened? Now, that's a little background. Now, let me go ahead and put some cerebral clarity to this, maybe. Because the Nazis literally went ahead and had their say at the end of World War II. They are they're an evil, evil, evil bunch, as we all know. But they were able to survive because they were able to compromise their lives by accepting information and science that up until that point we had no idea existed. Now, generations past, and I'm talking about hundreds of generations, have known this because they were there at the time the Nephilim roamed the world the first time.
You know, I've talked about that many times. What you're hearing tonight, what you're going to hear, is going to be kind of, I'd say this, shocking to you. Now, Greg, here's what I want to share. I want to share a couple things, and I'll turn it back over to you.
Sure.
In the last day, 24 hours, and then the last several hours, I've been told by someone who just returned from Argentina, who's very well connected than he is, and he told me this, that even Lockheed Martin, and they're known as the Skunk Works, they are the ones credited to reverse engineering spacecraft, alien craft, and both unusual craft from out of the world and from the inner world, okay? Yeah, you can look it up, Skunk Works, look up Ben Rich. The thing that's fascinating is he said that they have their reverse engineering team being brought in. So the military base is off limits to anybody except who the military allows in there. Obviously, different countries have different research bases, but when he told me that 1,000, those were his numbers, I queried him twice. He said, you know what they're looking for. You know what they're there for. And I said, absolutely. They found the ancient technology. They found the things they need to reverse engineer. They obviously are called in even where their expertise may exceed even the quote-unquote 135-year-old Nazis. So, Greg, can I get you to focus right now on the Antarctica and obviously what your friend and those in the know are talking specifically about the Antarctica, because I don't think that people recognize how critical this is, because this will be the launch. This is the key, and I would use the word skeleton key, and in this case, the giants, which you call critters, you know, they are in a form of stasis, and that's suspended animation, but something has broken them out of that stasis, and I believe the number you were given was 4 dozen. Is that correct?
Yes.
So will you take it from there, sir? And then when you get
tired, sure will.
You can turn it back. Thank you.
No problem. So they can go down 2, 3, 4 miles. That's usually about the limit before temperatures that increase and so forth make it difficult to go any further. But what has happened, and Steve, your statement, doesn't it give credibility to the fact that certain astronauts, by the name of Buzz Aldrin was down there. And I'll just simply say that he saw more than he probably bargained for, and left, and just decided it was time to get out the best he could. But why would he have been down there, Steve? I've been asking myself that over and over. And I believe because he was and is one of the few original astronauts, that he has the mental acuity to understand the science that has been handed over to the Nazis, at least to the extent that he can. No one has all of the pieces of the puzzle, but they've got plenty of them. And so I'm going, why would he be down there? And yet at the same time, the giants are in the process of coming out of stasis. And I believe it's because they're being released. The original one was released so they could study this giant. And you're talking about a creature 15 to 20 feet tall. Now, maybe you think you're tall at 6'4", John Wayne, but nope, that's not going to get it. These guys will step on you like a bad bug. So I just think that we need, again, to keep in mind what is at stake here. Now, when this began to unravel, and I'll digress just for a moment, still on the same subject. The tunnel that has been created, that's a couple of miles wide, I am told. I have no independent verification, but I'm told that. Until I get that, I'll have to go with this. And I'll tell you that so you understand that I do have room for error, and I'll admit it if it's my error. But if I'm told something, I'm going to go ahead with it and research the rest of the information based on what I do have and what I believe the area below the surface of the water into southern Argentina. And the tunnel that they have cut with tunneling devices, they're huge, just massive. And they can go 7 miles in a day. Well, it doesn't take too long to figure out that they're going to be able to go all the way up through South America, all the countries there, through Central America, North America, Canada, and into the Northwest Territories. So, what are we facing? We're facing a group of these giants, apparently some from a separate point of origin, that have found their way through all these countries into the Northwest Territories, where there are some rather large caves. And while exploring, some people heard, and one claimed to see, things that were otherworldly. They could not believe what they were seeing or hearing. And so when those gentlemen contacted me, what can we do? And I sought out some good minds, and they said, because the scent trail with DNA and so forth is so profound, the only way you're going to be able to keep them at bay, along with the weapons I told you about, of copper, solid copper, not copper jacketed, but solid copper, and these gentlemen have arrows, spears, bullets, and so forth that are solid copper. I have solid copper weapons, that is the ammunition. And why? Because you've got to defend yourself. You're not going to make it against somebody that's 15, 18, 20 feet tall. You will not. And so you must take the precautions that we've been talking about and put them into play the moment these things become visible. And so I said, now, set up a tripwire system where you've got some red lights, amber lights, green lights, I don't care what color lights, and a sound system that will let you know when these things are coming up. And so if you do that, you can give yourself the best protection you can, and the people of your tribe, your local villages, and even more than that. So that is where the northern aspect of this came in. Along the way, there have been appearances of these creatures in Bolivia and other areas in Central America and northern South America. They are being spotted, and the individuals that were sent in immediately by the country's equivalent of our special forces were not able to deal with it mentally, emotionally, or literally with tactical advantages and weaponry. So what did they do? Well, like always, they called up Uncle Sam and said, do you have anybody you can send down here? And my understanding is that they sent roughly a company of special forces operators and to look the situation over and find out what was going on. And the best thing that I can tell you is that there has been no one at this point, Steve, Doug, Joe, no one that has been able to come out of an encounter as they went in to the encounter. They have been changed. In some cases, changed to the point where within an instant, their hair went gray, and they had infirmities they never had before. And so we're talking about a situation that is beyond our ability to just deal with it. You know, when the sergeant comes up and says, look, deal with this. You don't deal with this. You have to do your best and hope you survive. Now, that being said, we're under a gun time-wise. What will it be? I don't know. Now, Steve, the only thing I told you about what I was going to say tonight was if I got a check from the Holy Spirit that I would not go beyond what I've said in some of these areas, so you understand.
Yes, I do, and I laid that out, I think, too, at the beginning. Greg, let me ask
yes.
you one thing, too.
Yes.
Describe what your sources are saying is a 2.5 mile wide, basically, underwater ship that's moving, and because, again, you know, there's so much garbage out there on the Internet. People are saying it's this or that. But what are your military and scientist sources saying about that?
Well, they are saying that there is a underwater craft, I guess is the best way you can put it, but that it is a Leviathan in size, something that, you know, if it suddenly surfaced and we had video of it, you wouldn't be able to take it all in. If they flew over it in a jet plane, it would take probably 30 seconds at least at 600 miles an hour to go from one end to the other. Now, that is what is keeping things together and also making it difficult to get an idea about, well, why is that needed? I can't answer that, except that I believe that it is a stronghold for those who are being sent to confront this series of creatures. And with the weaponry on board, the latest laser, sonic, visual weaponry that can take out anybody. And I will just say maybe the verse, as you said, if the time were not cut short, well, where would we be? And with any more than what we've got now, men's hearts may fail them for fear. Look, they didn't put that in the Bible to make it dramatic. They didn't choose to do this so that we would say, oh, yeah, I got it, I understand. They were giving warning, clear warnings. All right, do you believe in Atlantis? I don't know. I guess I could, simply because There's some evidence, but not enough to satisfy me at this point. I want hard evidence, and I'm seeing it in under the ice. I'm seeing it in Steve's writing. I have no issue with what he's put forward. I have no problem with the incredible work that he and his team have done putting the DVDs together so that we have a clear picture of how, why, and where this has evolved. Now, the last thing I want to say at this juncture is this. The events that have occurred under the ice have put individuals in harm's way big time. They only have survived because when they found out about it, even the Nazis, who thought they were indestructible, said, I'm out of here. And they began leaving, and the ships on the surface that have been monitoring this were confirming that this indeed was taking place, and they sent SEAL teams and Green Berets down below the surface in elevators that were the size of a half football field. And why? Because they had to carry large, extremely large, cargoes on board, tanks, artillery, and other such weaponry for this very possibility that is unveiling itself now. And so the people that have survived, that came out of there, and I don't believe it was a large casualty count, although I am told there was some. And I'm being told this by several high-ranking military officers. One in particular is the most credible to me. And, well, credible until he said, yep, I listen to Quayle all the time. That's why I'm calling you, because I want you to get hold of him. So, and I'm just kidding, Steve. He has great respect for you.
No, that's okay. You know, hey, Greg, I just got to share something. The late Sue Bradley, who was Admiral Thomas Moore, who was the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Sue was his lead researcher. And one time he listened to one of my shows, and Sue said before she even contacted me, she thought it was a little bit maybe too far out there. But he said this, and you know, obviously I'm saying this only to share the kind of the dittoing of it. Look, when God gives a man something, people can hate the man, and God knows I've engendered that in a lot of people. But you can't ultimately deny the fact that when something's given and proven to be from the Lord, it's real, okay? So Admiral Thomas Moore, you know, and obviously he made the statement to Sue. He said, Sue, listen to Steve. Listen to him carefully because he's telling the people what their future is going to be like. And Sue told me this. I think it's even on my website someplace that she said, and he said that I was the only one telling people of what the real war and the real battles will be in the future. Now, I'm not saying that to blow wind in my sails, contrary to my critics who say I talk too much. I hardly ever talk too much about that stuff. But why I'm saying that is this, ladies and gentlemen, that God is preparing his people for what's coming. And what's coming now is upon our doorstep. Or let's say it's at the beachhead. And what Greg is telling you is exclusive of me. I don't want to know. I don't know, for the record. Nor would I ever ask who his sources are, any more than he would do that for me. But the point is when the preponderance of evidence is tilting the scales, to the point is, Greg, I'll be blunt with you. I prayed lately. I said, God, did I throw away 35 years of my life warning and writing about this stuff because people don't? And look, I'm not feeling sorry for myself, but at 65, you know, I mean, I don't know what else I would do because this is what God called me to do. And he said, be patient. Well, you know what that means in my world. That means slow down from 200 miles an hour to 100 miles an hour. And sometimes the Lord says a complete stop. And I don't mean that on what I'm doing. It's just like this, okay? Let me share this because I'm going to to pray for a miracle, but we're going to put on a conference in Branson, Missouri. It's going to be the original innovators and the researchers and original writers on the whole theme of giants, fallen angels, UFOs. And it's on my website, ladies and gentlemen, Gen 6 Conferences. I've only agreed to do this because, quite candidly, I felt prompted of the Lord that the speakers are going to be Tom Horn, myself, L.A. Marzulli, Tim Alberino, Dr. Michael Lake, Derek Gilbert, Anselm P. Rambla, one of the most famous explorers in history, and it's all cutting-edge, up-to-date, original research. Now, are there people that need to hear this? My feeling is they all need to hear it, and it's going to be more of a teach-inar as opposed to a seminar. We limited it to six speakers, maybe seven, I think, and these guys are all, and most of you know all these names, but we're going to have a concerted effort to flow from the beginning to end. It's not enough just to tell you about the pyramids, what they mean, what the finds are, whether Ramesses the second statue, which has just been found, by the way, 24 plus feet. All these events are leading to something. And what we're telling you is this: spiritual warfare is not basically a choice you get to make. Yes, I will fight, or no, I won't fight. I guess you can make that choice, but the devil won't honor it. God will honor faith, but the devil won't honor you're saying, well, you just leave me alone, I'll leave you alone. So when the angels in heaven who have seen God's magnificence, who behold his glory, who absolutely love the living God, are watching what's going on earth, and when they start to say, woe, you know, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth, you see, you know, I get a kick out of it, Greg. You know you've been called it. You've been called a doom preacher, a fear monger. Everything I write is supposedly fear porn, you know. It's interesting because people get it all over the world, and they say, thank you. These are questions that I've had on my heart from the beginning of becoming a Christian. Now I see clearly. Well, God's placed a time lock on this information, just like you. You are on this program courtesy of the Hagmans, and God bless you, Doug and Joe and John, those of you who have made this possible, but for such a time as this. Because until the Antarctic meme came into the public knowledge, they couldn't receive it. And, you know, I've said this before, you know, it's like when we start talking about stuff, that's when God allows the release of corollary, and you know, people say, well, that's just a bunch of crazy Christians. No, it's not, because there are people who are not Christians telling you, and they're making it even worse. Now, I want to make this comment because it's critical. Notice that at the same time as the release of the Antarctic and the beings, the critters, which you call them, and I call them the giants, okay, the cannibalism meme and theme has come into the public psyche worldwide. Now, this is a critical issue, Doug, and I know you get it, and I know a lot of listeners get it, but the cannibalism comes from the word Cana and Baal, which means basically the land of Cana and the prophets of Baal, or Baal, some people pronounce it, or some people go Baal. But the point is no matter what you want to call it, look at the Arch of Baal and the world of the world's leaders. So, in essence, what you're seeing is a full-scale supernatural manifestation of the evil kings of the world getting ready to make war against God, the entities that have been reserved, you know, unto this day that are being released, and not all fallen angels are being released. Obviously, there's some that are bound in everlasting chains of judgment, but there's more than 200, about a third of the angels in heaven fell. So whether people want to admit the fallen angel meme or theme, the CIA, you know, their main name program is Weeping Angel. And so now we've got fallen angels. We've got the name of a spook, code name for a whole series of covert operations, Weeping Angels. And I said this on my QCast yesterday, I think, that Weeping Angels, if you want to look up the Gregori, G-R-E-G-O-R-I, a group of fallen angels that sing, and they're crying, they're weeping to God to forgive them. And the Book of Enoch says God will not forgive them. So the idea is this, that, ladies and gentlemen, please, if you want to get the stuff in one place presented very carefully, go on Gen 6 Conferences. You can go on my website, stevecoyle.com. Go over to the right-hand corner and Gen 6 Conferences. Click on it, and you'll read about it. I'm hoping, Greg, that we get the people that God has raised up, that God is going to release, to come and hear this because they've got to know the basis of their faith and what they're fighting for, and more importantly, who they're fighting against, and that the power that God has given, you know, people assume this. Look, you didn't, in your world of military and Green Berets and everything, they didn't turn you loose with exotic weaponry until you still had to learn how to break down and clean your rifle, okay? And unfortunately, most people think they're going into battle with, you know, their Bible, and if they have practical faith, and I would say faith that appropriates what they believe for, this is not the people I'm talking to. But I'm talking about the people that so haphazardly just think that somehow their idyllic walk with the living God will sustain them in the days and years ahead. It won't, because they're not being trained. They don't have battlefield experience, although they're going to be thrust into the battlefield, and they need to be trained. So that's what this Gen 6 conference is. It's called True Legends of Conference. And ladies and gentlemen, you can go on and start registering. The minute it went up, people started registering en masse. So we're limited to how many people we can have. But again, this is the only time you will get, and I think Tom Horn made this statement, just so you know. Tom and I have never appeared on the same stage on a conference. Obviously, we've been on TV and radio together. And Tom said, Steve, this is my last time. It's really critical that people understand that even in the last days, there have been statements coming out about the television spying on you and everything that is being recorded. Obviously, everything that is electronic hooked up to the net, hooked up to the brain, everything that's going on that way. And so what it's important, Doug, and I know you read Empire Beneath the Ice, but I think it's page 347 in my book, where I'm dealing with the idea that Nazis perfected the ability to not only project images like television. Obviously, they attribute that to what Farnsworth, if I remember my history of film and TV. The point is that the ancients had that perfected millennia ago. And what's more important is that, I don't know if you saw the story, Doug and Greg, but they're talking about being able to, intelligence agencies, literally plant, if you want, mental bombs in people. Did you see that, Doug?
Yeah. And by the way, that connection was not lost on me. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. So anyway, what we're seeing is a program group of people, and I believe that God is, I don't know how the Lord does what he does. He's God. I'm his servant, and Greg and everyone who loves Jesus, we're in this as he leads us. He's a good shepherd, but I don't want to be a dumb sheep. You know, I want to be up on the mountains with the rams, and I mean that. And so the thing that, Greg, that I think we really need to get through is whatever, and I'm going to say this, you know what I mean by this, whatever you're comfortable with sharing, you know, about the ship. Now, well, somebody sent me an email. Are you saying the ship is it the good guys, or is it the bad guys? Is it the Nazis, or who is the ship, the 2.5 mile long one?
Well, unfortunately, I have to tell you that this ship has been under construction for nearly 50 years, and all I can say about this is that it was put together with the idea that the so-called black covens of the world are going to be on board, as well as the Nazis and others who are working for Satan.
So basically, it's kind of, if you will, it's kind of like, let's just call it, you know, I don't know that much about Star Wars terminology, but it's the death planet or the death ship or the destroyer. And those of you who are Star Wars people, you feel free to correct me. But here's the thing, I think it's important. It's now in motion. The giants are now in motion. I got an email from someone that's saying, what's going on with the Russians in the Arctic? Well, the Russians are obviously dealing with the same thing in a different way and different technology. And Admiral Byrd's diary spoke about obviously entering the inner Earth through the, you know, Arctic opening. And obviously there are these Antarctic openings. But what's happening? It's a total manure is hitting not a single fan, but every propeller of every fan on the planet now is getting ready to be sprayed with manure. Now, that's tactful. Do you want to take it from there, Greg? That's as tactful as I can get.
Well, you put it where people can understand.
Is it your, and again, understanding how we prayed and understanding what where we want to go. And what I'm saying is, ladies and gentlemen, you can see that I'm wrestling too. In the back of my mind, and thank God I can dual process. I can't seem to stay on a given thought, but I can dual process. I'm saying, Lord, where do you want us to take this? Well, first of all, you know, here's the deal. In the Bible, start looking up Leviathan and Behemoth, or some people pronounce it Behemoth. And one of my emailers sent this to me, and I know this is a woman who has, you know, basically been an intercessor. And, you know, here's what she said. This was on August 22nd, 2014. She said, Steve, remember when I sent you the two words Leviathan and Behemoth that the Lord had laid upon my heart? You are hearing correctly, exclamation mark. And this is what she said. Now, again, this is what, almost 2 years ago. In a vision, I saw this gigantic animal monster walking on four legs the size of a dinosaur and almost looked like one, only it was not a dinosaur. It was a machine made from metal bars. As I looked closer, it turned into a real animal with skin. I realized they are recreating the monsters, the huge animals, Behemoth and Leviathan. Look it up. Then it came to me. They want to recreate the world to be like it was before the flood. Well, Greg, as you know, and I have never been in the military, but I get to hang out with some people that they can't say, well, that's higher than my pay grade. I got so tired of hearing that. I said, then put me in touch with someone who won't make that claim. Because, you know, and I've not been in the military, but people are only allowed to say so much at the colonel, major, you know, levels, blah, blah, blah. So the thing is that God was gracious and gave me access to four-star spec ops generals. I could not have done that. It has nothing to do with me. I want to make that clear. It has nothing to do with my failures, my personality, you liking me, you hating me, you wanting me dead, you wanting me alive. It doesn't have anything to do with that. God put me in contact with them because he said this, Greg, and I'm turning it right over to you. He said, Steve, if you'll be willing to warn my people, I'll bring the people to you that know what you need to warn my people about. That's the only way I can even have contact with people all over the world. They contact me. And I know, Greg, and you know this, that you've got to have multiple witnesses. You live in this world because obviously in your military experience, which, I know you don't like to talk about it, but I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, he walks the walk and talks the talk. But the point is that we're at this position in time where if the enemy is throwing everything they can at God's people better wake up, you know? And Greg, you've been as frustrated over the years as I have. But, I mean, you know, how would you put it into what I call Greg, the way you speak, how would you communicate to people? We're not on the good time Friday night titillate the ears of listeners worldwide. We're pleading with them in the name of the living God that God does not want his people destroyed. Yet history records that they don't want to listen to God. Or, quote, if you think we're not his messengers, then you shouldn't even have listened in the first place. But take it to the Lord in prayer. So put it into your words, Greg, and go for as long as you need.
Well, Steve, I guess, you know, when we start looking at this over the whole field of conflict here, excuse me, we're seeing that there is no way that we can adequately, at least I don't think I can, you can, I'm sure, but I don't have the words. I don't have the phraseology. I don't have what it takes to put that last nail in the, I don't want to say the coffin, but there's just no way to adequately present to people what we're thinking and going through. We have done everything. Oh, Steve, is it not easier? And I get, you know, we have our periodic phone calls where we check in and pray for each other and so forth. But wouldn't it be easier? Just wouldn't it be easier not to have to be involved with this? Leave it to somebody else. I don't want to. I'm 67 years old today. And so I'm
Happy birthday, my beloved brother.
Well, thank you, buddy. I tell you that I made it this far is a miracle of God. When I heard the doctor say probably won't make it through the night, as you mentioned, I said, well, all right, Lord, if that's it, then bring me a really nice plane to fly up to. But seriously, I just said, okay, I am ready. But if you've got anything for me to do yet, well, then leave me behind and tell me what it is you want done. And so far, considering that I couldn't walk, my legs were basically being sacrificed, which in the end, my beautiful wife said, no, you're not going to do that. You're not cutting off his legs. You're not going to, you know, if you can't do this, you're a doctor, you're a surgeon, known around the world. I was at Mayo's. And no. And so I'm learning to walk again. And I'm learning to, and I've gotten a good ways down the road, but I've got a little way to go yet. Be hard for me to run a marathon, but I try. But here's the deal. When we get up in the morning, I don't know about you, Steve, but I pray and then I go, all right, Lord, what kind of excitement we got today? And I'm praying for my wife. She had a heart attack a year ago and has really been mercifully saved and brought back to just virtually full health. And so I'm not sure why Liz and I have been singled out, I guess. No, that's not correct. A lot of people go through a lot of problems. But it's been very tough. No voice. Not able to walk. Not able to feed, prepare a meal. Nothing. I was completely dependent on my wife. And so to tell you, Steve, that I would rather have stayed off the phones with my contacts, military, police, and so forth, would have been far easier. And when I get accused of all kinds of things, and I get told that, you know, well, you and Quayle are just always harping about this and going on, but, you know. I don't think I could believe you. Well, that's your choice. But I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to quit. My dear friend Rod and Julie, my friends down in Lower Michigan, are the kind of people, and there's others down there as well. Philip, if you're listening tonight, God bless you. And Sheriff Darleaf and others, you're wonderful friends. I appreciate you, and I will stand by you. But I'll tell you this one last time. If you get in this arena, you better be ready to get yourself thrashed top to bottom. I've been in a lot of fights over the years, and I've walked away pretty slow on a couple of occasions, and I don't care to go through that again, but I will tell you that I'm going through it now, because the one side says, enough, Craig, enough, and I want to get on the phone and call you, Steve, and say, what do you think of that idea? I know what you're going to say. Don't you dare. And I would tell you, don't you dare. Do you realize, folks, that Steve Quayle and the wonderful help that Joe and Doug have been, but Steve has as well. But Steve has gone out without being asked, without trying to make a, you know, well, here, look at me, look what I'm doing. That's just not in his character. And I've seen him in just about all kinds of situations. And he wouldn't do that. He's not made up that way. But he's brave enough. And I say that, listen, it takes courage to do what Joe and Doug do and to do what Steve Quayle does. I'm telling you, it takes courage like many of you have only read about or heard about from World War II or Vietnam or something like that. And so when it comes on you like that, you can't just leave somebody out in the cold. And that's why my support has been, always will be, with Steve Quayle. Not somebody else that has got one iota of an idea of what they're doing, and others who just want to seek us out and give us trouble. Loads, carloads of trouble. Because why? Because they didn't think of it? No. Because they think they've got a better idea? No, they don't have an idea at all. But I'll tell you this. when it comes down to it, I believe, I just hope and pray that I'll be in the throne room in heaven when God calls Steve Quayle in and says, Steve, well done, good and faithful servant. And I just can't wait to be in a position to see that. And I don't know if that'll be possible the way it is. I think you're judged individually. But nonetheless, Steve, I want you to take it here. I need to take a little time and just, you know, you can go until...
I have chosen wrongly the wrong people to hire. I have chosen wrongly so many times, but when God gives you better friends, then you choose for yourself, and God's in it. That's how Doug and I met, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. And that's how Greg Evenson and I met. That's how Pastor David Langford and I met. That's how Henry Gruber and I met. And, you know, it's amazing. I hang out with some wonderfully gifted and talented men. I just ran through some of them there. And yet, in the back of my mind, I said, Lord, I can't undo the wrong decisions I've made, but please help me to make the right decisions. That's why, Doug, and this is important too, Greg, everything we're saying tonight, people, you must take it to the Lord in prayer. Yes. Because, again, it is that critical. And seriously, at 65, Greg just turned 67, I'd sing you the song Happy Birthday, but I would murder it, so I won't. But blessings in the name
Thank
of
you.
Jesus, and be strengthened in the power of his might and in the revelation that only God can send through the spirit of the holiness of God. So, Greg, you know, take your rest, take your liberty, and thank you, brother, for coming on and sharing what you know.
Well, I tell you, it's been a distinct privilege for me to be back with Joe and Doug, and certainly with you, Steve. Fortunately, I get to talk to you frequently, but fellas, we're going to keep up the fight. I haven't come this far and gone through what I've gone, 12 surgeries in the last year. That's enough for me. And so I'd rather be out fighting the big guys than going into the operating room another time. So thank you all. And thank you folks that are listening for your prayers and your cards and so forth of encouragement. I have appreciated it so much, and so has my wife. God bless each one. And Steve, I'm going to listen in because I want to hear what's going on.
God bless you, sir.
Thank you, Greg, and blessings.
Thanks, Greg.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's important that you heard that, because let me share this, and I'd like to thank Ale Marzulli, because he put me in touch with someone that I needed to get some info from. And Ale, bless you for this. And again, he's going to be one of the speakers. When we speak at this seminar we're having, you know, I turned down a lot of them because, number one, I've been asked for 17 years straight to go with Tom Horn to whatever those seminars. I've been asked by others to appear at seminars, and it never felt right. Okay. There was a time, Doug, I couldn't, but this time it feels right, because we're going to take people from the, if you will, cosmological origin of Warren Space all the way through the entire, what I would call, history and prehistory, and give people an understanding. I mean, we've got Dr. Michael Lake. The man is a gift. We've got Dr. Thomas Horn. And listen, I enjoy being on Tom. Tom made the same statement I made. You know, the only time we want to do any shows together are with you, the Hagmans, you know, because quite candidly, you know, if you get this too, Doug, but if I could tie up my whole life talking on internet shows, I won't do it. I love doing Sheila's show because it's so amazing. I love doing Dave Hodge's show because these guys are people that write their own stuff, and obviously I can relate to them. But as I said, you know, at 65, having burned the candle in the middle with a flamethrower, metaphor or picture I can get, you know, pretty soon you figure out that, man, where'd all the wax go? And the answer to that is you burn it up with the last flamethrower discharge, you know? So I want to make sure that what the Lord has called me to is transferred to as many people as possible. That's why, you know, this thing, and I got to tell you, it's important to me to get it out there that this will be probably, and look, only God, I've said stuff to the Lord, and he's made me eat, you know, my words, because I threw in the towel, and God said, hey, you're not even started yet, okay? So I want you to know that. But I don't foresee me doing seminars. You know, obviously, God blessed me with an understudy, Tim Alberino, the director and writer of the DVD series, The Unholy Sea, and the next one where there were giants. And people, I hope you understand, and this is just by the grace of God.